listening to the Jimmy Tebeau Show on KKID 92.9 FM, Salem, Rolla.
All right, well, you are here. We got Jimmy Tebeau and Steve and a couple of guests. Jimmy, how are you doing tonight?
Oh, I'm doing good. You know, this is show number two. We did that show last week. And I'm amazed at how well it went and how well received it was. And we put the video out. It got over 10,000 views, actually.
Absolutely.
I like this whole thing of videotaping in the studio.
Right, right.
But today we got another show lined up. I'm going to play some different music live in the studio this week. And we got some pre-recorded stuff that I brought in, some tasty live cuts. Part of it is going to be the Schwag playing with members of String Cheese Incident when we did those couple shows with them back in 2008 and 2009.
Right.
At Camp Zoe. Three members of String Cheese Incident were in the Schwag. It was the two drummers, Michael Kang on guitar, and then me on bass, and then our Schwag keyboardist at the time. We also have some guests today. Scott Micke, he's the owner of Peace of Mind Chain of Stores in Rolla and across the area. We'll be talking to him. And also we have Daniel Jones, city councilman for Ward 1 in Rolla, and Shelby Diane's here from Springfield, Missouri. She drove in. So we're going to have some good discussions today on a variety of topics. We're also going to be telling stories. And a little bit later, I'll have some bad jokes to tell. Because we did that last
week. You promise.
We did. No, last week we did the bad joke section, and it turned out better than I thought. You know, because even bad jokes are funny.
Well.
Even if the
we'll see.
Come on, work with me, man.
I'm working with you. Not your bad jokes, my bad jokes.
Oh, okay? Yeah.
Well, my bad jokes, you definitely don't want on your video.
Well, that one
and
you
we definitely
told me,
can't tell them on the radio.
Yeah, okay? That one you told me earlier is not shareable. Well, let's jump in the show. Scott, tell us about your stores. You got one here in Rolla. Peace of Mind is the name of the store, right?
Yeah, we do. We have a store over on Pine Street. Been there 2 years. It's amazing how well received we are here in the community.
What is it you sell over there?
You know, we sell a lot of like festival related merchandise, tie dyes, jewelry,
cool clothing. I've seen that a lot.
Right,
of hip clothes.
Right.
Really cool clothing. Heady glass. The big thing that we are is, you know, we focus on American made glass, mostly right here in Missouri. We deal with a lot of local glass blowers, so it's a lot of fun.
Oh, good stuff. Now, you have locations here in Rolla. What's the other ones?
We have locations in Rolla, Festus, Missouri, Park Hills, Missouri, and Sullivan, Missouri. So
wow.
Sullivan was our first store. It started out really small, and it just keeps growing.
I'm probably the oldest one in the room, but, I mean, we used to go to the head shops, and walking into your store reminds me of the 1970s head shops.
Right, and the cool thing about our store is that you can bring your family in with you,
right,
and then the adults can escape to the back room.
Exactly.
You know, it's just kind of a little bit of both worlds.
Well, I know we've got a lot more to discuss with him on some other things coming up. But
I think we should talk to Daniel Jones. Now, you're a city councilman for Ward 1 in Rolla, Missouri.
Ward 1.
Yeah. Now, explain that. How many wards are there in the city of Rolla?
There's six total. You've got two council people for each ward. I share Ward 1 with Jonathan Hines over there. But I'm really proud that I have Pine Street in my ward because we love to shop local, keep it small.
There you go.
That's cool. Now, that's an elected position. You ran for that, right?
I ran fast and hard.
I was going to say, how fast did you have to run?
And those numbers looked great that evening.
Oh, that's really cool. And you've been doing that for a while now?
I've been on the council for a year. We had a really high turnover on the last council. We got, for the first time, I think, in a long time, we flipped 5 seats on the council.
Wow.
And it looks to be like it's a pretty crazy race this time, too, with most wards. You've got several contenders up right now.
So then let's just ask the point-blank question. What makes you different than the people that, you know, need to maybe move their seat onto the other side of the track?
Well, one thing that
is that a simple way to say it, Scott?
Yeah.
Our council now is doing absolutely wonderful things day in and day out. Mm-hmm. And every hour I could tell you somebody's doing something. But what I can tell you is that I don't think that inactivity in local government should be tolerated by its citizens.
Right.
So I took that mentality myself, and I went and knocked doors and talked to people about that. And I found out that I wasn't the only one that thought that way.
Right. Right. And, I mean, being here for 21 years and you being here for about that long, coming down in the area, I mean, your show started back in the late 1990s in over at
down in Lusterville. Yeah. Yeah, and then we moved to Leesburg, and then, you know, I bought that property down in Salem, Camp Zoe, the old Camp Zoe. I just kept the name. and that was in 2004, and owned that property through 2012, technically. We stopped doing the events there in 2010. And Scott, that's, you used to come down there.
I did. I made it to every show there from 2005 on, except for the Big Summer Classic and the Underground Sounds.
Wow.
That's cool. And did you start vending there, or did you have a store at that time?
I didn't have a store there. You know, right out of the gate, I felt like I was at home. I was like, man, this is what I need to be doing. So I was like aspiring to try to get up onto Shaketown. The last show that I went to down there, I had set up a booth kind of illegally down at the bottom of the hill.
We call that the renegade vendor.
Renegade vending, right? So it's kind of what's, ultimately, it's what's inspired me to do what I'm doing. You know, the people that I've met over the years go into the events. That's where I met most of the glass blowers that I deal with now. So it's like Camp Zoe really set me up for where I'm at in my life today.
Oh, that's good. Well, you know, we worked really hard down there, and it was all of us coming together creating that. It was just my suggestion.
There was a lot of love there.
Jimmy, I've been to over a dozen Schwags myself, and what I can tell you is those shows with String Cheese are some of my all-time favorites. I'm excited to hear those today.
What I did is I dug through the videos of us playing those shows back in 2008 and 2009. There was some professional camera crew came down there. I think it was with iClips or something, but They shot the whole thing and never did anything with it. And then a few years ago, we asked them if we could have it, and they gave it to us.
Very cool.
Because they never really did anything with it. So I cut out three songs that we're going to play this through the show. Do you got one queued up? Maybe we can go into that here soon.
You bet.
Okay.
Which one?
How about Let It Rain?
Okay.
And this is the two drummers from String Cheese Incident, and Michael Kang on guitar from String Cheese Incident, and then actually this one, I think there was several other players on. Stu Allen's on this one, and there's a couple percussionists. Boy, you know, at Camp Zoe, the shows, the Schwagstocks just kept getting bigger and bigger.
They did.
And we were getting all these great musicians coming in from these other bands. And I'd be like, hey, you want to sit in with the Schwag? And a lot of them said, yeah. Which is, and on this track, also on percussion, is Giovanni Hidalgo came up from, I think he's from Puerto Rico or something. And he came in, I don't know how we hired him, but the world-class conga player, he's on this one too. And I remember this song because it's actually, I got to set up this song a little bit better. This song, Let It Rain, I was inspired to play it because I heard Derek and the Dominoes play it. It was an in-concert live double album that was recorded in 1970 at the Fillmore East. They released it in 1973, but it's this amazing live version of Let It Rain. And at the end, there's this crazy guitar jam in it. And we had all these guitar players on that weekend, so I wanted to set up this Guitarmageddon atmosphere. Like, hey, at the end of this tune, we're all just going to rip and jam and everyone see what they can do. So this is the Schwag, technically. We'll call it a Schwag Cheese Incident because 3/5 of the band are String Cheese members. Here it is, Let It Rain.
Thank you. You shouldn't give it back. Let it rain, let it rain. Let your love rain down on me. Let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain, let it rain, rain, rain.
One more time.
Let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain,
let it rain.
Let your love rain.
With the guys from String Cheese Incident back in 2009 at Camp Zoe, just south of Salem there. And it was really awesome when those guys came in. It was at a time the String Cheese, they weren't playing that weekend or something. And one of the guys that was working on management at Camp Zoe was a former tour manager of String Cheese Incident.
Wow.
And that is somewhat of the connection there. And he's like, hey, I could probably get some of these guys to come in, but they're not cheap. But we had a pretty big budget because we were selling like 5,000 tickets every 6 weeks out there. So we brought in some heavy hitters, and I'm like, can you guys just play the songs? And we flew them out on a Tuesday before the event, and I rehearsed those guys for about 2 to 3 hours, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And even in the afternoon on Friday and Saturday, we had a rehearsal room set up. at the upper level of Camp Zoe.
Right, so, in the garage up there.
Right, in, yep. the, in the shop, in the right. office. Yep. I set up a rehearsal studio. So when they got there Tuesday, I don't think they even had the set list yet. It's like, here's the 40 songs we're playing this week. And some of them are like, I've never even heard of this one. Like, I had Let It Rain on there. That and the Grateful Dead technically never played that. They have a song called Let It Grow, which right. We're going to hear later in the show, which is one of my favorite songs that they do. So it was really exciting and inspiring to play with these great musicians. They played both nights that weekend. And then, and it all started back in 2008 when I think two of the guys came out and played, and then the next year more came out, and then some of the guys from Leftover Salmon were there right. as well. So well, you were at that one, weren't you?
Yeah, yeah. I was at all of them. I was at all of them. I actually remember the time the String Cheese people were there, because everybody was like, there's going to be a full String Cheese incident. That was the rumor through the campground the whole time. So it was, yeah, it was awesome.
Oh, yeah, you know what? It was 2007 that they came down and did Big Summer Classic.
Right.
At Camp Zoe.
Right.
And now that I'm thinking of the timeline, because we were kind of talking to them in 2006, 2007, the Big Summer Classic happened. It was three full nights of String Cheese incident. Who else was on the bill? It was Del McCurry Band, Los Lobos, even Infected Mushroom was there, because, you know, because it was put on by Madison House Presents. But then that's what it was. String Cheese went on hiatus after that for a year or two. So they picked up some work with me, and they had solo projects, Iodo and all that.
Right.
So
it was, right. It was, I remember kind of, the eat.
Yeah. That was fun.
That's why. Yeah, so I wanted fun. To share that story tonight, which we'll get back in and out of that. I've got two more cuts that we'll get to in a little bit. But I want to get into somewhat of a topic. We'll call this section of the show the left wing agenda. Do we have any left wing agenda music?
Left wing agenda.
Tom Morello.
I got some Ted Nugent kiss my ass. Will that work?
That's right wing.
It's appropriate.
That is appropriate. I mean, you know, come on.
I mean, we'll be the opposite of the Rush Limbaugh show. And I want to talk about what's going on in Missouri right now with legalizing marijuana, because there's all kinds of rumors going around that, oh, it's going to be legalized, or, oh, they're not busting you for possession anymore, or oh, you'll be able to get it at the store soon, or, oh, you can get a medical thing. Do you guys know what's really going on? Do you have your finger on the pulse of what it is?
I know a little bit. Right now, this second, it's illegal, but we're well on our way. We're almost there. We did pass Amendment 2, which changed our constitution to allow for us to recommend cannabis to our patients here in Missouri. We're right around the corner from implementation. We've got I think they've collected almost $6 million in fees, so they've got the money to get everything going. They're fighting a few lawsuits here and there, just little sporadic things to try and get the language to where it needs to be.
Right.
We got some great people in St. Louis that in the Department of Health and Senior Services. Everybody's worried about the government's going to have their hands in my pot, and that's really not how it is up there. They really are working hard to make sure that the people's voice was heard correctly and exactly as we wanted it.
And that's giving, important. Giving, I guess what you're saying by that means is, first of all, you know, being able to grow some at home,
right,
without having to buy it and pay taxes on it and different things like that.
Mm-hmm. In fact, if you go get your card, that qualifies you. You pay $25 to get that card to go into the dispensary. That gives you up to 4 ounces, 4 ounces at a minimum a month, but you can get more than that if you have more than one signature. And then that's going to allow you also, if you'd like to, you can pay that $100 fee and you can grow for yourself and a couple other people. You can have, if you don't...
A caregiver's license.
Correct. If you want to be a caregiver and you don't partake, you can find 3 patients. That's going to allow you to grow up to 18 plants total, with 18 flowering and 18 separate plants that are not flowering. When also, that's going to be able to give you a storage to where you're going to be able to store a 60-day supply for each of those patients. So you're talking about 24 ounces of cannabis right there in the safe next to it to take care of those patients.
Right.
That's awesome.
So now you mentioned if you weren't a user yourself, you can grow for 3 other people. So if you want to, if you're a user and want to grow for yourself, you can grow for 2 other people.
That's correct. You can grow up to
3 people.
You betcha.
But if you're just a caregiver and different things like that, and you're just trying to help the person out,
yeah. And that's what this is all about, is helping our neighbor and helping your fellow person next to you.
Right.
Now, you're on the city council, so weren't you also the guy that used to stand up here on King's Highway with the sign that says, weed saves lives?
That's correct.
Is that you?
That was me. That was me and a lot of other good people. We went up there for months. I sat up there just to let people know, hey, Amendment 2 is here. Get ready to hit that yes on the ballot box. And I can't tell you, I got a few people that got mad, wanted to throw a few things and yell and cuss and this, that, and the other, and you hippie and blah, blah, blah. But I'll tell you what, I also had people delivering me Jimmy John sandwiches for no reason. We've got a great donut place here called Master Donuts. I discovered it because I got three donuts on three separate days, and I enjoyed every one of them.
That's so awesome. You're getting a lot of support out there, too.
And don't we? I mean, we're looking at, what is it, 70%+ of Americans don't want these laws to be in our way anymore. And
exactly.
We just,
and Jimmy, I hate to say it, we're some of the older ones now. Do you realize that?
I know.
You know, your kids that are turning 21, you know, and the big thing is about, in the whole, I think what you were saying, not to change the subject, but weed saves lives. You know, they're using it as an exit drug to get people off the opioid epidemic that we have here in this community.
Yeah, a study was done, and I think in Phelps County, it was 80-something pills were issued for every man, woman, and child, infant here in Phelps County. We were a problem child for the opioid epidemic. Wow. And it's, you want to see the opioid epidemic here in Rolla, I can take you some places and show you what it looks like face to face, and you can see the neighbors that we have that have gone through this hell.
And unfortunately, it's in every one of our families.
You're right.
You know, it's not something that someone is uncommon with. And from the way I look at it is, if they had a choice whether to smoke some medical marijuana or eat it or however they want to ingest it, for the same relief that they're getting from their opioids, give them the opportunity to do it.
I have 2 points for you there. One, cannabis is a safe, non-toxic alternative to all that crap they've shoved down our livers for so long. And the second part of that is your Missouri state constitution now tells me and you that if a doctor is going to offer you anything that's going to cause dependency, you've got the right to say, no, thank you, I'll have that cannabis card instead. And you're going to go home and you're going to help your body out safely and organically.
My doctor told me I was boring. That's all I can really say. He just told me I was boring. He goes, how can you be so old and you're so healthy? Just like, well, you folks figure that out.
Figure that natural alternative out.
Exactly.
Look, a lot of folks in town know I'm a disabled veteran myself, and I've told people plenty of times there's only two things that really help with some of the things I deal with, and that's counseling and cannabis. And one of those was illegal up until now, so I'm living a celebration now with what's coming.
Right. Yep. So, we all are.
So your stance out there on the King's Highway with the sign was drumming up support for the amendment vote.
Get that conversation started. I've always told people action is super, super important as long as it starts a conversation. We don't have to have an end game at the end of every conversation, but as long as I'm having a conversation with someone who's wearing a suit and tie, and they're going to go have two more conversations about, hey, this city councilman said this, or I'm pretty sure he might have been a little medicated at the time, but it starts those conversations, and that's what's important in this community.
So did you ever get any hassle from any of the churches?
I have not. In fact, I've gotten nothing but I work hand in hand with a couple of our churches here in this community. I'm on the crisis intervention team here in Rolla, which battles the opioid epidemic.
Right.
And part of that is I work with the Mission and the Vineyard Church and places like that. And I haven't heard blowback one. And especially when you help these folks, and if you get a little blowback, you just help them get a little education by explaining to them, hey, it's either this or it's this.
Right. Right. And I think that's what I'm saying by there's not a family out there that doesn't or hasn't had this experience with a member.
No, we've got to kick the opioids in the teeth around this community. And I think we're doing a great job. Our chief of police has got his mind wrapped around the addiction that's happened. And we are very blessed to have the law enforcement in this town that we have.
And I agree with that 100%.
That's good stuff. Now, on the marijuana issue, does that mean in time in Rolla there could be a dispensary or something like that? Now, didn't you guys make the front page of the Phelps County Focus newspaper, and it was something about a dispensary coming to town? I remember I saw the pictures of both of you in there.
What
was that story?
We, you know, with everything that's going on and as supportive as Rolla's been, we've decided that, you know, being a part of that is something that's very important to us, not only us, but also the community around us. So we have sent our money off to the state of Missouri. Our goal is to grow, manufacture, and distribute So we will be making the edibles, we'll be growing our own cannabis, keeping it right here in the community.
So that consists of three different
licenses. It's three different licenses, yeah. Manufacturing, right. Cultivation, and then distribution.
Okay. Yeah.
So it is sent off. We're just waiting on the Department of Health and Human Services to actually give us the application to fill out.
Right.
Once that happens, you know, it's just sit and wait.
Right, right.
So you're telling me they're already accepting money from people in Missouri to apply to be able to grow, produce, retail.
Yeah,
yeah. The applications flowers. Will be ready in July, correct?
They had to have the money in order to...
To start the process.
Have the manpower to create the rules.
Right.
So, you know, the people that was really interested, right. That's what they did. They were right. Like, well, it's kind of like right. Rolling right. Your dice.
Right. Part of the wonderful thing about the way we implemented Amendment 2 is that we're keeping it Missouri. The jobs are going to be in Missouri. The plant has to be grown in Missouri. Exactly. The money to start the businesses has to be Missouri money.
Right.
We're starting a brand right. New industry from the exactly. Ground up, literally.
Exactly.
Which is part of the farming industry, which was kind of one of the first... you know, industries in the state of Missouri.
Well, and you know, they just did the whole hemp thing where Missouri is going to start doing cash crops for hemp again, which exactly. Is huge.
Right.
You know, we're going to see the whole economic structure of Missouri start growing significantly.
What a acre of hemp is going to yield for?
I have not.
$5,000 to $15,000.
And they're starting with 40-acre tracts, right. You know. So this is going to be huge for these people that own this property that used to farm that can't afford to farm anymore.
Right, right. So the maximum you can do is 40 acres?
The way I understand it is the maximum right now per person is a 40-acre tract.
Everything
based
is...
Based off the property owner?
I think it's per license. But you can now
can
somebody
you combine can, licenses you can, and rent farm land?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's all I need to know. And that
he's like, I've got some property.
Yeah, well, about 100 acres, so
that industry is very fluid right now, so there's a lot of development. So if something ends up being not enough, they're going to be changing it to where it's going to cover the industry.
And it's never going to be enough because hemp will replace everything.
Exactly.
You know, won't cut down trees no more. You know, you can make plastic. You can
everything. Yeah. You can make diesel fuel from hemp
for sure. So this is a huge thing as far as
absolutely
literally going green.
Right. Yeah, if that's the way you want to look at it, I mean, that's a great way to do it.
Yes.
All right. Well, Jimmy, looks like you're picking up a guitar and want to do a little singing for us, huh?
I'm all inspired. Like, we got all this talk about marijuana. I was thinking, I got to know a song about marijuana. So we're all hanging out with some friends here, so let's see what I can get going here.
We're gonna sit down in the kitchen, fix us something good to eat. Make ourselves a little high, make the whole day seem complete. We're gonna lay around the shanty mama and put a good buzz on.
You see, it's going along with what we were talking about.
Pass it to me, baby, pass it to me slow. Take time to smile a little before you let it go. We're gonna lay around the shanty mama and put a good buzz on. There ain't nothing to do. And there's always room for more. Fill it, light it, shut up and close the door. We're gonna lay around the shanty mama and put a good buzz on. We're gonna sit down in the kitchen, fix us something good to eat. Make ourselves a little high, make the whole day seem complete. We're gonna lay around the shanty mama and put a good buzz on. Even in Wednesday night in the radio station.
Woo. We're gonna lay around the shanty mama
and put a good buzz on.
Yeah. We're gonna talk about legalizing marijuana in Missouri because that's part of the left-wing agenda on KKID radio.
I mean, it's kind of the hottest thing on the agenda right now, you know, and different things like that. And I'm really glad to see that, you know, it came out, the vote. I mean, they came out strong.
I mean, you want to talk about a percent. We hit it out of the ballpark in Phelps County compared to most of the state even. So we've got a lot of support right here. I mean, your neighbors are supporting you here in Rolla. Your neighbors' neighbors are supporting you. When it right. comes to cannabis, we're there.
Right. And I have a strong belief because of the opioid epidemic that we have. And
I've lost friends.
I have too. I mean, I just, my best friend, we lost his son, 26 years old, on February 14th.
It's a shame.
Yep.
Here's
fentanyl,
a little
fentanyl heroin cocktail, boom.
Here's a little known fact about the Schwag, because we don't advertise it too much, but you know, a lot of people know over the years we've had a lot of different band members. You know, I call it never ending cast of musical characters, but two of the guitarists in the Schwag over the years are dead now, you know, and it's you know, right. due to problems we're talking about, but
exactly.
not going into detail, but it hits home, you know, and you see it in your friends, and
yeah.
So maybe legalizing marijuana will turn that all around.
You know, for every one of those stories that I hear, and I hear a lot of them, I really do, I find 10 more people that have been affected in a positive way from cannabis. So I know that this is a real thing. The states that do what we're about to do, opioid deaths and overdoses drop by 30%+
exactly.
in every single one of these states, with the exception of one, which was 29%. And that's what I want right here in my community. Not just that, I want to be the one that takes that cannabis to the folks that have the problems. I want to bring them into right. the shop. We want to get them in the dispensaries, and we want to show them that there's an alternative out there to all right. this junk.
Right.
Yeah, anything exactly in moderation. Right. Now, the one thing that I'm kind of confused about, that I bet, Scott, you would know exactly about, what's the whole CBD thing all about? You even see billboards on the highway. It's come get your CBD oil. And you sell CBD products.
We do.
In all four of your stores, and it's a popular seller, correct?
Well, actually, we sell them in three of our stores. Okay. Franklin County's still trying to wrap their head around the whole legality and CBD.
I'm confused by it, too. Is part of marijuana, or where does it come from? Is it synthetic?
No, it's definitely not synthetic. So CBD is it's cannabidol. It comes from a cousin to marijuana. It's the cannabis sativa L plant. It don't have THC in it. And I mean, it does, but we're talking about under 0.3% THC per ounce of dried weight. That's like the definition. So they're growing this, and it's the same process as marijuana, except they're growing it extremely high in the CBD, the cannabidol, which helps with things like inflammation or anxiety, sleep problems. And it's not something that you're going to smoke or eat or take and get high. You're going to take it over a few days, and you're going to start noticing relief from some of them symptoms. It's something that builds up in the body.
Yes.
The body's designed to be taking in those cannabinoids, you know, not necessarily just from, you know, pot, but from, you know, the plants. And it helps out naturally inside the body. It's awesome.
So is it oil?
There's tinctures. There's, you know, you can vape it, you can eat it, you can smoke it. It comes yep. in several different ways, and
yep. it really does come in most of the forms that cannabis comes in, because yep. it's an extraction. Yeah, you know, you can do everything mm-hmm. from your edibles to your waxes yep. to your flower. Our flower is very popular.
Yeah,
that's if you saw me out in the parking lot before the show, that was CBD.
Yeah,
you know, and the awesome thing about here in Rolla is they've understood the difference. They know the difference, because the flower, if you set it here on the table, it looks and smells just like marijuana. The difference is the amount of THC that's in it.
So if it went for a lab test, say you got pulled over and they caught you with this flower that looks just like regular marijuana, but it's CBD flower, then they would test it and see that it's not a high enough THC content to be charged.
Most of the flower, the way it comes into us, is actually 0% or 0% THC.
Wow.
You know, most of the isolates and the oils will have like 0.03%, where typical marijuana, you know, you can get 20, 25, 30% marijuana. So,
well,
I mean,
and that's just with the flower. You know, you go into your extractions and it gets up into the high 90% range.
For sure, yeah, 93, 94%. You know, the Ninth Appellate Court had actually ruled that THC, naturally occurring THC that falls outside the scope of marijuana, does not produce a psychedelic effect. That's the CBD. And that's the therapeutic part.
Right.
Wow, that's really cool how progressive things are becoming in the whole field.
Changing so fast.
Well, and on top of that, I mean, you know, obviously there's a CBD extraction that can be done from a marijuana plant and the THC left out. But what we were talking about as far as the hemp is concerned, the hemp is not federally regulated. So if you get a high-yielding hemp or a high-yielding CDB hemp plant, you can do whatever you want with that because it has no federal regulations over it.
Yeah.
And it provides you the same amount of product and the same amount of relief as what the other CDB oil does, which is a lot of people are moving into that from the standpoint of being able to ship it and
yeah. The 2018 Farm Bill, it opened up interstate commerce wide open when Trump signed that. It opened it up to where you can actually mail your hemp through the mail. And it's kind of funny because sometimes you'll get a box, a shipment from Colorado or wherever, and when it comes in, you can tell it's been opened, and you know, but every
okay,
shipment.
Let's check this out.
Right, because you get a box and you can smell it,
yeah.
You know, and every box has got test result or testing sheets in the box. So, yeah, I mean, it's cool. It's neat to see that this changing as fast as it is,
yes.
And I do believe
yes.
that we're going to see full legalization on a federal level. Probably in the very near future.
Yes, yes. Actually, you know, I believe that too. Just based on everything that's happening with the heroin and mm-hmm. the fentanyl and different things.
Well,
like
and you
that.
you see legalization coming from two different platforms right now. You see it coming from the opioid epidemic causing. You know, you see
right.
people being helped that way, but you also see a lot of work right now in social justice reform and jail reform, prison reform, things like that. And what we're finding is that those two things, cannabis. The what I call the illegal and archaic prosecution of cannabis walks hand in hand with that jail reform. So I think we're going to see legalization dangled in front of us in 2020.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
They got my vote.
And well, I mean, think about it from the standpoint of if you were given a choice whether you could legally smoke and have marijuana recreational or medically versus, you know, having the alternative of the heroin and the fentanyl and the cocktails that they put together. You know, and the crime getting caught with that is going to be very severe.
The alternative,
what would you choose to do? And when we were talking about it earlier, I was thinking about the educational level of, you know, I hate to say it, but, you know, the amount of opioids that are available in every medicine cabinet across the United States is unbelievable. And when the kids don't have any education and they see their parents taking this stuff like it's candy, you know, what are they going to do?
I've said this all along that I feel like, you know, when I was younger, you know, mom always had something in the medicine cabinet. The doctor always gave her something. Oh, she was feeling a little rough that day. She'd take this or take that. And I feel like there's been a whole generation of addicts created.
Absolutely.
Just based on, oh, well, the doctor gave it to mom. It's got to be okay.
Exactly. I mean, and when you see that happening over and over again, and your kids are in junior high and wanting now to do heroin because they're not catching the buzz because they've been stealing their parents'
right.
you know, prescriptions.
My dad had a medicine cabinet
happened.
Next to his bed in the little brown box with the papers in there, and he's a very healthy guy now. I mean,
so what I'm getting out of all this is in Missouri, marijuana is going to be legalized on a medical level first.
Correct.
Like you got to go to the doctor, get your approval or what's it called?
Recommendation.
And then with that, once the dispensary opens, you can go in there and flash the recommendation and then you get a card or something.
You'll get your card sent off for.
Yeah, it's a little more involved than that.
Oh,
but
yeah.
You will at that time be able to have 30 days of being able to go in the dispensary and make your purchases until you get that card.
Yeah.
And then a great byproduct for the community, besides a lot of more happier people, is the opioid epidemic drops by 30%.
I'll read you something real fast.
What do you got?
I've got a list of ailments, but I won't read them all because it's crazy how comprehensive and how many ailments we're taking care of here in Missouri. We cherry-picked everything from all the states that worked and left behind everything that didn't. And the two that I think are the absolute wonders here, and it covers most anything you can imagine, but also chronic medical conditions that cause pain or spasm, including PTSD, and any chronic medical condition that's normally treated with prescription medicines. That tells me that any time that somebody's going to offer me something that's going to be addictive, I can tell that doctor, no thanks, I'll have that cannabis card instead.
So, right. So to be fairly easy to get the recommendation.
And most of these states have done this. It's been seamless and organic and easy. Everybody starts to panic a little when it gets closer. Like, how is it going to screw up? Is this carpet going to get yanked out from underneath us? And it's not.
And from what I understand is you get your recommendation from your doctor when the applications become legal. You take that application and your recommendation and send it in. Now, if you don't hear anything back within 30 days, you keep a copy of your recommendation. That now becomes your medical card that you can use. Once you're approved or you haven't heard anything within 30 days, I'm assuming you're good to go. And if you've got a license for a caregiver, you can start growing.
Those cards will be available for you on the 4th of July, Independence Day.
Yeah.
I'll be in Colorado at the Dead and Company show, but you guys tell me how it went back here.
You know, we got another guest in here I want to introduce. Shelby Diane, she drove in from Springfield, and she's got a bit of a perspective, and maybe this is part of our, we were talking about the opioid epidemic, and her, from her perspective, she's around 21 years old, and a female, so has any of this affected you? Have any of your friends been affected by any of this?
Female or male, honestly, yeah. My family members and my friends a lot. Not just recently, but within my 20 years of living, and I think it's gone a little bit too far, like you guys were talking about.
Right.
And so I, that's why I'm basically working on my holistic healing book, which will be at Birds and all that.
Yeah. Now we know Shelby.
And Shambhala as well.
We know Shelby because she is a performance artist. She does hula hooping and dances on stage occasionally with the Schwag. And her first big festival appearance with the Schwag will be at Birdfest, May 3rd and 4th in Ozark, Arkansas. She's done some nightclubs with us recently at Crave in Springfield, where you're from. That's kind of where we ran into you doing those shows. But her and me were talking about, you know, that our friends dying from opioids and that. And it's like, oh, is that affecting your age group too? And apparently it is.
Yeah. Within the creative scene, there's a lot of people who are faking a lot of fake realities and looking for alternatives in darker, deeper spots, which I'm really looking forward to this marijuana movement because the alternatives are insane. It's not just marijuana. There's so many different alternatives. The medicine is in the plants for so many different things.
Right.
And the opportunities are out there, and I honestly feel as if there really is no one to blame other than a lack of awareness, honestly.
That's what I'm saying.
Throw a little bit of blame around because, and here, let me tell you why. These companies that have put all these poisons out for so long, the biggest problem that we have, the reason that we've called cannabis the big gateway drug, right? It's the big gateway drug. It's the one that leads to all other roads, right?
Right.
Except it's not when you get it from a dispensary. If you force me to go see a drug dealer to get cannabis, what is a drug dealer going to do? I mean, I know some decent guys, but some decent folk, but some of those folks are going to have other drugs, right? That's what you're basically, when you're going to some drug dealers and you're going to go get cannabis, they're going to offer you other things. There's going to be other things around. I want to get my cannabis tested and a wonderful product from wonderful people at a wonderful dispensary, written and recommended by my wonderful doctor, so I can go home and feel wonderful.
Right, most definitely.
Not poison my life.
Sounds wonderful, doesn't it?
Right, and we want the pharmaceutical industries on our side and be able to trust them, but honestly, it's been a lack of awareness overall. There's been so much held back due to a lack of trust. Who to blame, honestly, corporate, who put a label on it. Over time, we have developed there's so many alternatives pushing us to realize that there is one answer. And it is, I'm not going to say plant-based, but not injecting all of it with these unnatural chemicals.
Right.
There are, you know, grass-fed alternatives for meats. I know I'm not dissing meats, but the drugs, why?
Yeah.
The medicine is in the plants, the fruits, the berries, the woods even, not only the leaves.
Food is medicine.
You can put the woods in water and just make it into a tea and brew it, and it's really good for your intestines. And why is that important? You tell me. I want to know your answer, honestly.
Look, being healthy is important because we only have a certain amount of time on this earth before we've got to go on about our other business. So, I mean, right. It's important for me to be healthy for my family. It's important for my family to be healthy for me. It's important to take care of your neighbors and your friends at the same time. Food is health. Food is medicine.
Right. What you put in, you get out.
Right.
Period.
Right.
Period. There is a simplicity to life that I wish people understood. And that's why I say that there is no one to blame other than a lack of awareness.
Scott from Peace of Mind put it right. He said that we have that system in our body ready to respond to those cannabinoids already, right? So we want to make sure our body functions at the best way that we can. And to me,
and not only that's cannabinoids, cannabis. And not only cannabinoids, there are so many different alternatives, like herbs, flowers, berries, so many different fruits and vegetables and. Chicken, you could really eat some chicken that is grass fed. I love chicken. Some chicken, but it's gotta be grass fed, but I'm not eating it right now. But grass fed chicken,
there you go. Good. So, that's are you a vegetarian? Good. Is that what you're saying?
Currently, yes, but in my future, I plan on eating some more chicken.
Eating some more chicken.
Later. Oh, okay. I'm like detoxing my body right now. But
how long and now, how long have you been doing this? How long have you not been eating meat?
7 months now.
7 months, okay.
Do you feel different?
Honestly, I was diagnosed with depression at like 5 years old, so the 7 month period that I have not ate meat all my life, that I've had depression and had to work with that, and that's where a lot of people come in with opioids and all that other stuff.
Right, that they want you to take for your depression.
Yeah,
right.
And you know, fill in that void that everyone's trying to fill in. So after I stopped eating meat, my depression kind of took a turn on my mentality, as well as the other healing alternatives that I use.
From a positive standpoint.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Very so good. Was it a red meat that you stopped eating?
I ate a lot of meat.
Just
I
any
everything.
Meat.
Okay, like my family meat. Would like make me eat everything. I would eat everything. Everything is so good. I love food. Let me tell you, I don't look like I love food, but I love food. I would eat donuts. I would eat chicken. I would eat
so
much everything. I mean, a poor girl's diet. You know, I made it on my own wherever I'm at. You know, I had to eat what I needed to eat to get through. Ramen noodles. You know, whatever. I feel for everyone that, you know, go to opioids that don't have any money and they just want to look for that scapegoat, just throwing that out there. But, you know, there are different things. You can take the time to not eat and just drink water, honestly, and eat your fruit that is only 99 cents and you can get by. But when I stopped eating meat, it took a whole turn on my life and everything just rapidly started happening and for my life.
Really, that's awesome.
This ties into once again the left wing agenda. You know, this is the show where you're going to be hearing about hippie stuff such as crystals, you know, meditation, chakras. I'm setting you up here. I'm setting you up here. You know, I watch your Facebook posts, which I find are really interesting, Shelby. You know, sometimes it's paragraphs that I'm like get through the first couple, and I'm like, I got to get her on the radio. So tell us about some of your holistic living approaches, and don't be shy and don't hold back.
Okay, no, I'm not shy. You're just funny. I'm sorry.
Yeah, scoot up a little bit more.
Okay.
Right up there.
Okay. My alternatives that I have, really just pretty basic in general. But I mean, it's not common because they're not taught to us anymore, and there's no one to blame for that. There's absolutely no one. And I took 5 months out of my life trying not. Just 5 months. 5 months, I rapidly found the vegan alternatives, but it took me a good year or two to figure out why I would want to do that in the first place.
Right.
Because.
Okay, so speaking of that, you know, take a guy my age who is, you know, loves his meat and potatoes, so to say, and how do you convince a guy like me to say, you know, it's going to kill you. And there are better alternatives.
Yeah, it's honestly, I would say that's what my Mimi would tell me. It's all about how you want to live, how you want to, how you feel, because we're all made of different things. We're all made of different properties. We're not all made of the same things. That's why we have different hormone levels, different chemical levels of whatever. But why do people have a lot of cancer right now? Right.
Well, I think it's eating a lot of processed foods. You know, it's like if we all eat more natural, organic
and
foods.
And what's in processed foods, like artificial sugars that are in a lot of other things. It's like one little chemical that's in one thing leads to another thing. And it's just, as you simplify it, it's easier to look at.
Right.
This thing where marijuana is getting legalized and at the same time there's a lot of more people dying from drug overdoses.
Right.
And I thought it was just in my age group, and you know, because on Facebook sometimes mm-hmm. that becomes the obituary. You know, it's like, oh, you know, every week, you know, you're seeing, oh, somebody died. No, here's a memorial and blah blah blah. Right. And it's like that guy was young, but to hear that it's going, and to hear someone like Shelby come in and talk about, hey, I'm in that age group and I'm seeing there's a problem, and I'm pointing it out to my friends. Because sometimes that person that's like, hey, everyone, maybe we should slow down a little bit, that's the person that's like, oh, you're a nerd or whatever. No. I mean, we're all partying. I mean, I'm a professional rock and roll musician, and I've done my share of not doing moderation, which I've learned the hard way a number of times. So I'm here to tell the cautionary tale. But then I'm the same guy that's like, come on out to Schwagstock, let's party for the weekend.
Right.
But there's a safe way of doing it, and we want to do it year after year. We've been doing the Schwag Band for 28 years. We've been doing these Schwagstock events for 22 years. And there's a number of people that I see that have been doing it there with us. But then there's some that aren't there doing it with us anymore. It's because they burn too hard too fast.
Right.
But, you know, we want the show to be fun and uplifting, too. So maybe I should play another song on the guitar. We have time for this, right?
You got another hour, Jimmy. What are you talking about, time?
Oh, I'm going to do a 28-minute solo acoustic Dark Star.
All right. You do that. While you do that, I'm gonna hit the, what, you know, that, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll play some Bob Marley then. Oh, wait, let me get this mic just right.
Oh, pirates, yes, they rob I, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit, but my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We flowered in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? That's all I ever had. Redemption song. Redemption song. Emancipate yourself from inner slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of us can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets when we stand aside and look? Some say it's just a part of it. We got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? That's all I ever had. Redemption songs. Redemption songs. Emancipate yourself from inner slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy. cause none of us can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Ooh. Some say it's just a part of it. We got to fulfill the book. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? That's all I ever had. Redemption song. The songs of freedom. Redemption song.
I was reading some stereotypes once, and I was reading one on guys with dreadlocks, and apparently it's a well-known fact that every guy with dreadlocks can play Redemption Song. And when I read that, I'm like, I can play Redemption Song. So I mean, I guess I'm feeding into that stereotype.
That's funny.
Which, I don't know. I think we've officially hit the comedy portion of the show, don't you think, Steve? Is it time for those bad jokes?
It's time for the bad jokes.
I mean, people know.
Do we have a drum roll back there?
Do we have? We got some stuff back there for this part of the show, don't we? There. Okay.
That'd be tight.
Wait. Okay. What do you call a guitar player without a girlfriend? Homeless.
Straight up.
You see, I can tell, again, I'm a musician,
I've
so I can tell musicians.
I've met a lot
musician.
Of girlfriends that are still homeless. Though.
I thought it was the bass player. Oh, wait, you're the bass player.
I changed the joke. Okay. I didn't want to be the complete victim here. Here's another one. How do you know a musician has stayed at your house? They're still there. You're right. They're still there. I've heard that. How do you know a deadhead has been at your house? That's kind of interchangeable.
You haven't kicked them out yet.
Okay. Now, what's the difference between...
She thinks they're pretty funny.
Well, come on, give us some of that love.
Oh, my goodness.
All right. These are supposed to be bad jokes, Shelby. You're supposed to be booing.
Really,
we got laugh tracks.
Okay.
So what's the difference between a pizza and a drummer?
One's good.
No. A pizza can feed a family of four.
Yeah.
They both have mushrooms.
I was gonna say the pizza was good anyway.
No, that reminds me of another joke. What do you call a guy that's hanging out with a bunch of musicians? A drummer. Yeah. The drummer in the Schwag loves it when I tell these jokes.
Dave.
Okay, here, I got one more. What's the difference between a guitar player and a lawnmower? Mm. One cuts grass and the other smokes it.
Ah.
Which ties into our legalization thing.
Oh, boy.
Very good.
Who else has a joke? Shelby, you got a couple? Come on.
Okay,
get right up there and tell us these jokes. What are they?
All right. So what's the difference between a hippo and a Zippo?
What's the difference between a hippo and a Zippo? Like a Zippo lighter.
Mm-hmm.
What is it?
One's a little lighter.
One's a little lighter.
Good one.
Oh, that was I had to think about that one.
Yeah,
that has a double meaning.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
It's
right.
Supposed to be bad jokes.
Right.
Well,
okay.
Yeah, you picked a good one. I'm glad you brought some bad jokes.
All right, so why does a mermaid wear seashells?
You got me on that.
Because a B cup is a little bit too small, and a D cup is a little bit too big.
All right.
Uh-huh. Get yourself a mermaid, though. She's perfectly balanced.
I guess.
We were talking.
Now you got me thinking.
I,
come on, Jimmy, pull it together here, buddy.
No.
Get the mermaid out of your brain.
I know. I'm thinking mermaids and boobs. And the fact that a girl told a boob joke.
Exactly.
You know, because I was thinking about doing a boob joke. But
focus, Jimmy.
The whole women's rights thing and whatever.
You betcha. We're bossing up this year.
You go.
I know. I knew I was taking a risk having Shelby on the show. She would judge me harshly and let me know later. I'll probably get a long message through Facebook later. Anyway... News of the Weird, I want to share some of these stories that are real stories that came out recently. In Topeka, Kansas, police took the joy out of Joyride on March 16th for Nicholas Hogden. age 40, who climbed into a forklift outside of a Dillon's grocery store that evening and set off down the road. The forklift, valued at $1,500, had been left outside the store with the keys in the ignition.
Ooh.
Now, a spokesperson for the police department said bystanders saw what happened and called police, who apprehended this guy as he drove along holding an open can of beer. He also had a six-pack in the back. He was booked at the Shawnee County Jail on one count of felony theft and misdemeanor counts of driving under the influence and transporting an open alcoholic beverage. This was all according to the Topeka Capital Journal just last week. So
that was St. Patrick's Day weekend.
I know. It's like you would expect some craziness. And we had played Topeka, Kansas not too long ago. And that town actually rocks. We did a two-night run at the Convention Center Holiday Inn. What was the name of that hotel? Do you remember? Not in Ottumwa. I was out in Topeka. Anyway, that town rocks. We ended up there early the night before the two-night run, and we ended up at a little karaoke bar, and I got to tell the story. Our drummer, we were doing karaoke at this bar, and our drummer is with us, and our drummer, you know, I'm telling drummer jokes. I got to put a drummer on the spot. Our drummer never sings. We never give him a mic. It's a joke that we're going to give the drummer a mic because he doesn't sing at all, has never tried, and doesn't want to. So we're at the karaoke bar, and we're all taking turns, the rest of the band getting up there. And we're like, let's get Dave the drummer up there. And we're like, what's he going to sing? And we figured it out. The song Tequila, it only has one word in it, and it happens three times. So you know what song I'm talking about? Da 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 Tequila. So I asked the chick doing the karaoke, I'm like, do you have tequila? And she's like, yeah, but are you sure? I'm like, yeah, it's going to be a challenge for this guy. But he got up there and nailed it, you know, and he did it good, and just his presentation and all. And I don't know if he was in key or not, but it's just his enthusiasm. But that made me think about the Tebeau story. I do have another story that just recently happened, which will tie into kind of our next phase. Did anyone else have any jokes before I... Scott, do you have any jokes?
I got one for you.
What
did the snail say when it was riding on back of a turtle? Whee!
Oh. Wow. Okay,
that's my favorite joke. I think my kid told me that.
Okay. Well, here's another story that's going to tie me into another story. Outside the Northfolk Correctional Unit in Sayre, Oklahoma, Carrie Jo Hickman was arrested on March 10th for delivering contraband to prison inmates. Hickman's clever delivery method was a T-shirt gun used by sport team mascots to shoot promotional shirts at fans. Hickman, however, launched some lucky con on the other side. She was launching, here it is, a list of stuff. Methamphetamine, cell phones, earbuds, phone chargers, digital scales, marijuana, tobacco, all you know, shooting it in a T-shirt gun over the wall into the prison. So, you know, that some lucky con on the inside could grab. But apparently she got pulled over as she was going to do this, and they searched her car, found it all, and she got booked on introducing contraband into the penal institution and conspiracy and drug trafficking. And this was on the Associated Press. This just happened last week. And, you know, I did some time in prison, you know, about a year up in Yankton, South Dakota.
South Dakota.
And that was a thing. Now, the prison I was at, it wasn't the maximum security with the big walls. I was in what's known as a federal prison camp, so there technically wasn't even any walls. In fact, the dorms we were in, the doors didn't even lock. But if you weren't where you're supposed to be during the four counts during the day, then you were hit. And it was pretty monitored. But there was stories of, you know, these guys would have their buddy or their cousin or somebody drive by late at night and throw a duffel bag in the yard or whatever. But these guys would have to go out there and get it. And sometimes they would get busted getting the contraband. And surprisingly, the big thing in there was chewing tobacco.
Wow.
You know, there. And I was at a federal prison camp, but I've heard, you know, stories from guys that came in from other prisons that at certain prisons you can get pretty much whenever you want, and it's a lawless environment. Where the place I was pretty strict, and if you did get caught with contraband, it was a big deal.
Right.
And what's funny is while I was in there, I had They had a music department, and there was actually I was in three bands while I was in there. But one of the musical groups I belonged to in there was a heavy metal group. These guys just couldn't find a bass player, and I know heavy metal from way back.
Well,
you know,
sure,
I
was that in was your
Maiden,
era.
Yeah, Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, so I could play some Metallica, and I just wanted to jam with everyone. But and these guys, the two guitar players in the band, really great guitarists, cool guys, and they had been there at this prison for like 7 or 8 years. They were some more of the longer running guys. But after we were in the band for a while, we were trying to figure out what to call the group, and we thought it'd be funny if we named ourselves the Contraband. And we did, and we actually played some gigs for the other prisoners. But what it gets better. The guitar player in the band asked me if I wanted some tobacco, some chewing tobacco. I was like, no, I'm cool. I'm like, why, can you get it? He's like, dude, I'm the guy here. I'm like, really? He's like, yeah, 8 years strong. They've never caught me. He's like, he's got some regular thing where his cousin or whatever would throw him, like, they would get the big rolls of you know, where it's like 20 or 30 cans of chewing tobacco in a row.
Right.
He would take them and break them down into little baggies, you know, and somehow he made money doing that thing. And really, once you get money, you just buy commissary, or he's trading commissary items. But the plot thickens. While we're in this band and we rehearse twice a week and then we have a show coming up, he finally, after all these years, gets busted. Like, he's in the bathroom, you know, sitting down like he's, you know, going to the bathroom, and he's in there twisting up his little bags, and then finally the guard catches him red-handed, which means he loses all of his privileges, such as playing in the band. And so that's funny that the Contraband got broke up because of Contraband.
Wow.
Yeah. And then it's like a month he couldn't play in the band. And then about the time he came back, the other guitar player got caught sneaking. We had a garden at the prison, and certain prisoners went out there and worked on it. Now, the vegetables from the garden went to the cafeteria, and we all ate it anyway. But some of the guys thought it would be cool to try sneaking some of the vegetables from the garden into the dorm, and food in the dorm was a no-no. But they considered it a challenge. Like, I'm going to get this vegetable into the, so I can eat in there just because I can't. But this guitar player, he had a big duffel bag filled with vegetables from the garden, and he got caught smuggling it into the dorm. So he also got hit with Contraband. So we really lived up to the name.
Wow.
Right.
Well, I'm curious of how he tried to smuggle a whole duffel bag of vegetables.
Well, I don't think he
stuffed it under his shirt or what.
No, yeah. I think he just threw it over his back like it was a load of laundry.
Oh, okay.
He was doing some laundry or something. All right, and they were like, hey, is that really laundry? Oh yeah, sure. You know,
it looks a little heavy. Who knows, huh?
It wasn't. No, prison was a real trip. But I remember my first day going there. I had never been to prison in my life, and you know, here I got to go. Originally, it was a 36-month sentence. I ended up doing about a year there or whatever because I got in some program, and then I was at the halfway house 6 months
right.
in St. Louis. But my first day in prison, I'm pretty nervous, and it's a thing where they let you turn yourself in on a certain date.
Right.
You know, so I knew this date was coming, and, you know, I got to take care of everything, which was cool. The attorney worked that out. And then friends drove me up there and dropped me off like at 11 a.m. I had to go in the office, and that was it. And I remember on our way, right before they let me off, they're like, hey, do you want to smoke some weed? And I'm like, gosh, I don't know. And I hadn't smoked weed for like a year or two because I was on pre-sentence trial, you know, and probation and all that. So I'm like, well, what do I got to lose? What are they going to do? So I get really baked. And then I go into the prison and I got to pretend I'm not really baked. And one of the first things they did, well, I wasn't too sure. I wasn't too sure. And later on, I found out it was a good thing I didn't. But so I get in there and the first thing they do is they strip you down totally naked and search you because apparently a lot of these guys like to smuggle stuff in.
Right.
You know, and it was even as far as completely nude, bend over, spread your cheeks and cough, you know, type situation. It's like, so I'm really high having to do this, which has happened to be before, not at a prison, but, you know, another time I got arrested in San Francisco, which I'm saving that for another. That story's another time. I'm going to finish this one, though. So I get the new clothes on, and then they sit me down through, and they ask me all these questions and that, and then they send me over into Kingsbury in the basement. Kingsbury was, there was three halls there, and every new prisoner there starts out in the basement of Kingsbury Hall, which is the roughest place you can be. And it's like, if you've been there for a while and you're still in the basement of that hall, then you're not doing good. So you start there, and my first day in, I got in the room about 3:30 in the afternoon, and, you know, there's about 20 guys in this one room that I'm assigned to. There's 20 bunks, and half the guys in there aren't even speaking English. You know, there's a lot of Mexicans, a lot of black guys. There's one other white guy in there, so I'm relating with everybody. I can get along with anyone anyway, no problem. So I'm like, hey, what's going on, hey, blah blah blah, and they could tell I was a greenhorn. and what's funny is at 4 o'clock the red light comes on and everyone gets real quiet and everyone gets like right up by their bunk, and that's the count. And nobody explained the count to me yet, but they did. They're like, hey, blah blah blah. Everyone got real quiet. It was rowdy in the whole place. So the count happens, we're all quiet, and within a minute or two or three guards come in and they count the number of people in the room. And they count everyone, it's a national count, I've learned this. They count you four times a day to make sure you're there, and then they turn in this national count. Well, they came through, and then I could tell that they just did that whole floor and they had three more floors to go. So they went up, right when they left our room, you could hear them go up the steps, and everyone was still quiet. And just then, another guy from another room walks in and starts beating up the guy standing right next to me. And the guy standing next to me was this big Samoan-looking guy that wasn't speaking English. Like, I wouldn't pick a fight with him. And they just start going to town. And the rest of us, like, back up against the bunks. And everyone's just letting them go at it. And they're fighting. And then after a minute or two, they break it up. And the other guy runs out. And I had heard that federal prison was not very violent, and I also heard that federal prison camps are for nonviolent offenders.
They lie into you.
So the first day, I see this fight, and I'm like, "What is going on?" And I'm at the back of the room, and everyone else in there has been there for a little while or whatever, and they can tell I'm green, and I'm kind of like, my eyes are real big, and I'm still baked, you know, I'm still high from there, and you know, it gets quiet for a minute, and then one of the guys turns to me and looks at me and smiles. He's like, "Welcome to Yankton Federal Prison Camp." And I'm like,
"Wow!"
And I'm like, "Now I heard that doesn't happen all that often." They started laughing, and they're like, "The one guy's like, man, I've been here 5 years, and that's the first fight I've seen." and apparently, it's extremely rare.
Wow!
And my first day, boom, that happens. So that was my first day. Oh, and to back up a little bit, when I got interviewed, when I got there, a nurse looked me over, and my heart rate was up a little bit, and I'm high. And she said, "Are you on any drugs? Are you, you know?" And I said, "No, no, no." And it's a good thing I didn't say anything, because apparently some guys show up there wasted, you know.
And like, they don't accept you.
Well, they accept you, but they put you in the hole for like 2 weeks. Ooh. You know, just a mandatory dry you out, because wow, we don't even want to deal with you.
Right.
We're going to bring you food three times a day.
And that's it.
Yeah, so I just skated by. But that's my first day of prison story that I wanted to share with everyone. You know, so can we play a little bit more of that string cheese and the schwag?
Absolutely. Which one do you want to play?
Oh, okay. What else do we got?
Oh,
there?
We got Saturday Night and Golden Road.
Let's do the one more Saturday Night. This is what we closed a set with one night, and it's just a great epic jam. It's the Schwag playing at Camp Zoe in 2009 with three members of String Cheese Incident playing in the band.
Tonight, it's Saturday night. dance, dance now. Local robbery with a basement full of dynamite and lava to the reed. Temperature keeps rising, everybody's getting high. Come the rock and stroke at midnight, the place is gonna fry. It's Saturday night. One more Saturday night. That's right, it's Saturday night. Comes on the news, says I ain't no satisfaction, that's why it's in the blues. It's not so don't go crazy, no, we know just what to do. Crank up that old patroller, put on your rockin' shoes. It's Saturday night. One more Saturday night.
That was the Schwag playing at Camp Zoe back in 2009 with the members of three members of String Cheese Incident.
Awesome.
There.
Awesome.
The two drummers and the guitar player, and me on bass and vocals, and a keyboardist. And actually, I think on that cut, Stu Allen was also playing guitar, who's currently plays with Phil Lesh.
Wow.
Yeah, and you know, Phil Lesh being the bass player of the Grateful Dead.
Absolutely.
And but talking about Schwagstock before we go too deep. The Schwagstock event started 22 years ago. We've been a band for 28 years. And the Schwagstock event is happening again this summer. It's going to happen July 26th and 27th at the Shrine Camp in Waynesville, Missouri. And it's Schwagstock number 48 in the
48.
Series.
48.
Yeah, we're doing, it's the 48th one. Yeah, believe it or not.
I know.
And the Schwag is going to play both nights. That's my band. We're going to play 2 to 3 hours each night, different show each night. There's camping available. Now, this Shrine Camp, it's called the Shrine Camp because it's ran by the Shriners Club, and they're the part of the Shriners organization that does the children's hospitals. To where it's a portion of the proceeds of this event is going to help their cause and help the children's hospitals. And the Shriners themselves, there's about 90 of them that are members there at that club. They're also, several of them are going to be working the event, which is really neat. So they're very supportive. And it's cool that Schwagstock has maintained all these years. Of course, while I was in prison that year, it didn't happen, but now it's back. And we do festivals all over the country, like we do two Bird Fest events down at Bird's Adventure Center,
right,
in Ozark, Arkansas. You've been down there.
Yes.
Scott, you've been down there with us.
Awesome time down there.
Yeah. So, and Bird Fest is an offshoot of the Schwagstock. Just, you know, we were kind of hot in Missouri for a little bit when the whole Camp Zoe thing happened. And in one of these future episodes, we're going to dive deep into that whole Camp Zoe story.
Yes.
I don't want to go too deep, too hard right now.
But, right.
But we do need everyone to know that Schwagstock is alive. It's still happening. We did it last year at the Shrine Camp, and it went fantastic.
That's right.
You know, a number of people are like, oh, we'll see, you know, how this one goes.
Right.
And we still had a fantastic crowd. And that facility holds about 3,000 people. So we can get a crowd of people in there. They have two nice shower houses. They have a clubhouse with a full bar. The Shriners, they'll be selling keg beer there. They said they're getting kegs this year, and they'll sell you beer, you know, if you're over 21.
Right.
And the profit from the beer goes to the children's hospitals.
There you go.
Very, very cool.
And we're going to have 20 vendors there on top of the band, like the Schwags playing. So is the K Brothers from Columbia, Missouri. Now, the K Brothers are burning hot right now. They recently sold out the Blue Note Theater,
whoa,
Rose Music Hall, and then there's some theater in California, Missouri, where they're originally from. They've sold that out. So they're doing extremely well. And they're this kind of this bluegrassy group. There's two girls in the group that play violin. Another group we're having for the weekend is the Driftaways. They play a lot of reggae and ska music. They're playing for the whole weekend. We got Jake Willis. He's a favorite from the old Schwagstocks.
Yeah.
You remember Jake Willis? He's got a beard longer than mine, and solo acoustic player. And then we're going to have 20 vendors as well, and one of our main vendors is Peace of Mind. And we have Scott here, the owner of Peace of Mind. And you're sponsoring Schwagstock this year. You're one of the proud sponsors. You're going to be one of the main slots on Shakedown Street there.
Super excited to be there. Like I said, you know, Camp Zoe, the whole Schwagstock experience really, you know, launched me into the experience that I'm in now. So it's humbling to be able to be a part of it. It's awesome that it's continued, and, you know, it didn't let what happened stop it. Because the message and the amount of people that you bring together is just inspiring. So super, super excited to be about it, you know.
So you're renegade vendors sponsoring it now? Wow.
That's
amazing.
He started out as a renegade outlaw vendor at the Camp Zoe. Because, you know, it was pretty cutthroat at Camp Zoe towards the end with vendors. We had 40 vending spots, and we'd have up to 400 vendors apply. And especially the food vending. So many people wanted to do food, but we kind of figured 5 food vendors was about right for that size crowd to where they could all make money, and we made sure all 5 of them had a variety of things. But there were so many tie-dye vendors that wanted to do it, but you can only have so many tie-dye vendors. So we're continuing that tradition. This event, we've got space for 20 vendors, and we're hand-picking them all, and we're starting to confirm them. And Scott's on board. We're doing a big Peace of Mind booth, and we're also doing ticket giveaways at your store, aren't we?
What's, yeah. What's that? Yeah, we're definitely going to be doing some ticket giveaways. There'll be boxes at the store, so stop in. You know, there's no purchase necessary. Stop on in. Put your name in. It's awesome to be able to see, you know, the customers that come in every day in your store. It's awesome to see them at outside of that, you know, at a completely different environment. So we're excited about that too, and it's always fun to hook people up, you know.
Now, which stores are you going to be doing that
we're
at?
Actually going to be doing tickets at all four stores.
Our four stores. Okay. Yeah. Very cool.
Well, I mean, everybody from here to right. Park Hills, Missouri
right.
knows.
Right.
You know.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
The Schwag yep. family runs deep.
Well, you know, I mean, I feel fortunate to be able to be involved with it as long as I have. I mean, I met Jimmy before he even bought Camp Zoe down at Ozark Outdoors.
In Leesburg.
In Leesburg.
In 2001.
Right. And that was, I think you did that season and then one more, and then after that you bought Camp Zoe. So you were at Camp Zoe in 2003, correct?
2004, spring of 2004. We
right.
took control, or you know, bought the property in March, and by May we were open, right. ready right. to go. Even though yep. we weren't ready, we opened the gates, and
I remember
we thought 2,000 people were going to come, and it was 4,000.
Right,
and we were
right.
ready for two, staffed for two, had the grounds. We fit everyone in. We had some complaints. We apologized to some people, and we're like, "Hey, don't go to that other place. Come to the new place.
Yeah,
it's better."
Right, right. Well, I remember the first time I went down there. I actually turned into the driveway prior to the bridge that took you back to like what you guys would have considered campground two.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And I got lost, and I almost got stuck because I went down, tried to turn around, you know, on the road that goes down to Sinking Creek right there by the bridge, and I was in the KKID van, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, you know, I didn't think to go across the river and up wow. the left, and it was just a directional thing being down there for the first time, but once you got down into the grounds and different things like that. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it really took off. You know, after that first event, we just kicked it into high gear and put in a lot more roads and a lot more electricity and built the stages bigger. And it just grew from there. And
yes.
it grew to where, you know, I was surprised at how fast it grew.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I think the government did too. You know? But now it's a beautiful state park. Yeah, Echo Bluff State Park.
Yeah, it's a beautiful state park.
And so
I told him last week they need to actually give him that state park back. $10 million and a dispensary license.
I agree. I agree.
We'll call it Jimmy Tebeau State Park.
No. Yeah, definitely.
Oh, my. You guys.
Well, they think about it. The state would make their money back so fast it'd make their heads spin.
He could keep that place packed all summer long.
Yeah. Yeah.
Schwagstock 1200 this year.
It could be a weekly event. The radio show is weekly, and so is just Schwagstock.
That's right. There you go.
Oh, my God. That you would guys be are blast. Beautiful.
All right.
So, you got something happening on April 20th coming up at the store?
Yeah. Yeah, we got a 420 event. We're going to have a huge sale. We're going to be giving away some stuff, some of those tickets that we talked about. There's going to be an info booth set up on your rights and as far as the information.
I'll be there with some tables and some I actually have a big event at another place. I'm giving a big spiel about cannabis, so it'll be kind of nice to kick back with the actual patients and customers and help them with to get through what the process is going to be and give them all the information that they're going to need to be happy and healthy customers and patients.
There you go. Oh, that's good stuff.
And I think Scott's gonna have some giveaways too. It's gonna be a yeah. fun day. We're gonna load the day. We told you
that's a Saturday.
Here to us,
we're gonna load it up with live music all day too.
To awesome. Us, the 420 event's almost like what most people look at Black Friday. You know what
right.
I mean?
It's so right, Green right. Friday.
Definitely stop on in and take advantage.
There you go. There you go. All right, Jimmy, looks like you got your guitar in hand there.
You know, I told that prison story, so I got to play a prison song, right? It's only appropriate.
Yeah, Jimmy, I did 156
did I drop the soap
days
on
in
purpose?
Jail for cannabis.
Oh, that's right. You've done some time, too.
I did 156 days, 256 days here in the Phelps County Jail.
Phelps County Jail, huh?
For distribution of cannabis.
Wow.
Now, so you did all your time in the county jail?
That's correct. I had a $300,000 bond over my head.
Oh, my
so
God.
I sat in that jail and refused.
And they didn't do anything to reduce it?
They brought me up for bond reduction three separate times, and all three times I refused the bond reduction and said, until you guys see cannabis for what it is, put me back in the pod. And then on Christmas, they kicked me out of there.
Oh, really? Huh. For no money? No.
A little bit.
Oh, they really dropped
it ridiculously
right.
without my permission. I was actually pretty mad about it. My attorney was better than I wanted her to be.
Uh-huh. Well, That could be another story at another time as well.
All right, well, I'll play my prison song.
Woo, woo.
You know, I heard county jail is a lot worse than where I was. I was at the federal prison camp, and I heard the county jail is not the place to be.
Yeah, I can tell you some stories. Yeah,
oh, I bet.
Yeah.
We'll have to talk after the show.
Just don't wear their jumpsuits, bro. You come out there with bed bugs all over you.
I hear that train coming. It's rolling round the bend. Ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom prison. Time keeps dragging on, and that train keeps rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't you ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. Whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Yeah, I do. Look out. This prison and this railroad train was mine. Move it on a little further up the line. I go far from Folsom prison. That's where I want to stay. I let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
You know, I was talking to one of those older bluegrass musicians the other day. And I was like, what's the secret to getting that whole bluegrass feel? And he's like, well, think about a train rolling down the tracks, and you gotta get that groove. And I started thinking about this song, you know, like right there, you're going down the tracks, and then you get that, woo, oh yeah. They feed me from this prison, and this railroad train was mine. Move it on a little further up the line. I go far from goals of prison. That's where I want to stay. Let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Something like that.
There you go. All right, we got the Jimmy Tebeau Show in the house here at KKID. And, you know, this is our second show. We started last week, and, you know, here we are at the second week. We already got a new sponsor, thanks to Peace of Mind.
Absolutely. Thank you, Peace of Mind. Welcome. Welcome to KKID.
Right. Super excited to be a part of it.
Oh, it's going to be a blast.
Well, before we end up, are we going to hear one more of those string cheese songs?
We got one more of those, but I think, Daniel, you wanted to add a little something about on expungement.
We were talking about folks that were locked up for cannabis and other things like that. What I wanted to mention is that we actually have some pretty amazing things happening in Missouri right now. We've got it to where because cannabis is now we're a med pot state, that means that folks that have two misdemeanors on their record or one felony, you can get all that expunged right now. You can expunge up to two cannabis misdemeanors and one felony cannabis. But they have legislation going right now that's just shy one vote, and I think they're going to get it real soon. But it's going to expunge all misdemeanors and all felonies from your record of cannabis related. So that's going to be pretty good for
you
folks.
You mentioned one felony. I mean, what about people with multiple felonies? Or
right now, you can expunge one felony and two misdemeanors for cannabis. Now, in the future, if this legislation passes, which I'm going to be making a lot of calls this week to a lot of politicians to try and ensure that this happens.
Is it based on how long a incident happened?
Simply, if it's cannabis, it's gone. You're going to expunge it if it's cannabis. So
I'm talking about multiples. You know, one's back in the 80s and one's like in the 90s, you know, I mean,
legislation that's going by now, there's no time frame. It's simply if it's on your record, it doesn't need to be on there because it's medicine now.
Yeah, okay.
But they've got, like I said, in Jeff City right now, we've got actually a couple Republicans that have got this law they're trying to put through onto the books that's going to expunge everything cannabis related.
That's amazing.
It is.
So let me ask you this then, from the standpoint of someone who had some felony convictions and they get them expunged, does that allow them to apply for, you know, possibly a extraction license or?
Sure.
Okay.
In fact, many states are being proactive about that. We're making sure that the industry can be filled with the folks that have been in the industry before illicitly in that gray market.
And I gotcha.
There's a lot of states that are proactive about that, and that's right. Kind of what we're doing here.
And that's
otherwise, yeah. We won't have any employees that know about pot.
As unfortunate it is to say, you know, I mean, that's the truth. But then again, you know, in the states that it's been legal, I mean, my son, he's got a what's considered a caregiver's license out in Colorado, and you know, I've learned a lot from him. So mm-hmm. I'm ready to buy my lights and my hydroponic equipment. And
I know Scott and I both visit Colorado quite at least once a year. I go up there. My wife and I are renewing our vows at the Dead Show on July 5th up
all
there.
Right.
Yeah, Folsom Field.
Oh, Folsom Field. Yeah. Okay, because speaking of string cheese, I mean, I was fortunate enough to actually see string cheese last summer at Red Rocks.
Very cool.
Oh, man.
Beautiful awesome venue.
Oh, my gosh. Oh, very my cool. Gosh, yes. Wonderful, wonderful. So,
now, did you see Phil Lesh is playing in St. Louis? You
saw yes,
that?
I did.
Yeah. That yep. Him, Phil Lesh, the bass player of the Grateful Dead, he's got his family band together, which, you know, has his sons in it, but it's good players. He's going out with Willie Nelson.
Yeah.
It's a double bill, and they're playing. It's at the end of June. It's the last Saturday of June, I believe.
And Willie's going to have his kid with him too, Lucas Nelson.
Oh,
now is this Outlaw Festival they're having at
38 bucks?
Yeah.
Is that all?
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? And there's a lawn package too.
Oh,
a family of four can go for like $100
yeah,
or something.
Wow, that's incredible. Yeah, because I mean they've got
Old Crow Medicine
exactly.
Show.
Exactly.
Allison Cross.
Yes.
Union
yes,
Station.
Yes. I mean it's going to be a full day show. It's got to start at least by 1 o'clock.
Jimmy's going to play acoustic over on the fence line for it.
Yeah, I'll be out in the parking lot. I'll be renegade
with Scott.
Right.
We'll set up a booth.
Yeah, Scott will set. No, that's funny. June is such a packed month for shows. The band Fish is in St. Louis for two nights at the beginning of June on a Tuesday and Wednesday. It's the weekend right before Bonnaroo because they're going down there to play that. But that's a Tuesday, Wednesday, and then that Friday and Saturday of the same week, Dead & Company are playing in Chicago at Wrigley Field. So that week, I got to go to four concerts.
Right. Wow.
And then after the fourth concert, I have to walk down the street from Wrigley Field to this little club that holds 150 people, just down the street walking distance, and I'm playing a gig. I got hired by this all-star band, and I did it a few years ago, and we're going to play from like midnight to 3:30 in the morning nonstop. And in the band, I'm a hired gun, but the guitar player of the group is Mark Caron, who played in Rat Dog with Bob Weir.
Oh, wow.
And he's done gigs with Phil Lesh, and he was in that Further band when they first came out.
Exactly, I remember
or
that.
Or the other ones. They right. called it something. But and I've done gigs with him before. So that's going to be a power. I'm going to have to really pace myself. Two Fish shows in St. Louis, two Dead & Company shows, and then a late night gig all the way up.
Your life is difficult, Jimmy.
It sounds fun.
I feel so sorry for you.
I'm bragging. Jeez. I wish all weeks were like that. No, it's going to be a hard week, though.
No doubt.
We mentioned string cheese. Do we have enough time to play a song?
Absolutely. We got some string cheese lined up. Now, is this another one that you were playing
with?
Yeah,
this is the Schwag with members of String Cheese Incident playing with us. What's the title there? I forgot.
Golden Road.
Oh, Golden Road to Unlimited Devotion. Yeah,
right. And then now to mention, you know, String Cheese is going to be playing at the Fox Theater in St. Louis on the 19th and 20th of April.
They are.
Right, they're coming up here, you know. Oh, yeah. My God, beautiful theater. But imagine seeing String Cheese in the Fox. So,
yeah.
I'm actually going down to see Government Mule
in Springfield.
Yeah.
So many good concerts coming up,
yeah,
everyone.
I mean,
get out there.
Boy, they're
some
popping
shows.
Up everywhere. So it's
Warren
like.
Hands is on my bucket list.
Oh, man, buddy. Have you not seen him yet?
No, it's just that we haven't been the same spot at the same time.
Yeah, wow.
Good time.
Well, here it is.
Golden Road to Unlimited Devotion by the Schwag at Camp Zoe with members of String Cheese.
Well, see that girl, 5 foot in the lawn, whistling and singing, she's a carrying on. There's a laughter in her eyes, and
dancing in her feet. She's a neon diamond. She could live on the street. Hey, hey, won't you come out and wait? Come and join the party every day. The sun, nobody's finished. We ain't nearly begun. Kick off your shoes, child. Take off your hat. Put on your wings to find out where it's at. Hey, won't you come out and play? Come and join the party every day. Hey, won't you come out and play? Come and join the party every day. Fall out for a while. Sun's coming in and it's going out of style. Light out smoking, honey, and have yourself a ball. Your mama's down in Memphis, won't be back till the fall. Hey, 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 won't you come out and play? Come and join the party every day. Hey, hey, won't you come out and play? Come and join the party every day.
You've been listening to the Jimmy Tebeau Show. That's me. I'm still kind of freaking out. They gave me my own radio show. Appreciate everyone listening. I want to thank our guest today, Scott from Peace of Mind.
Thanks for having us.
And the city councilman.
Blessed to be here. There you go.
I'm so proud of that. But we're going to be back next Wednesday.